Once upon a time, it was really like this. However, now we got to talk about it. Maybe we can put it back together.
So many problems in my life, I just couldn't deal with it. I started drinking, thought it would help ease my pain. But things got worse. I said, Lord, I give up. And that's when my life began to change. Oh, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Woo! Praise Him. Y'all go on and take your seats. Hallelujah. You know, to be honest with you, once we praise like that, once we give God His due, He is pleased with us. And when God is pleased with you, there is no good thing that can be denied to you. God is a good Father. He's a sovereign God. He is love. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is my up. He is my down. Daniel, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I fear no evil because I know. Look at your neighbor and say, I know. God is with me. See, when you can walk and you can talk and you can strut and you can shake your thing and you can say, I don't care what the world got to say about me. But me and my house, we gonna serve the Lord. Hallelujah, somebody. I want to recognize my friend Bishop Horn back there. Y'all praise God for him and his lovely wife. Hallelujah. Oh, we praise God. Oh, we are thankful. We are thankful. Hallelujah. Did y'all tell my colleague and my young friend, Elder Annette Laveau, happy birthday this morning? Praise God. His birthday is 2 days before my own, so I can't forget that. Amen. You know, I tell you like this, if we celebrated Jesus half as hard as we celebrated ourselves on our birthdays. Woo! When I was in the working world, I didn't even come to work on my birthday. I'm at work today because it's my birthday, but I'm at work today. But my job now is more important than my job was when I was in the world. You see, so I don't have to worry about missing work on my birthday because I enjoy my work. I guess that tells me something. Maybe I didn't enjoy my job. Yeah, maybe my job was really work. This is not work. I love this. I do love this. I'm praising God for my wife. She, on her way to the dentist office on Tuesday, and I'm telling her, hurry up to the dentist because we got to get back because Bible study is Tuesday night. And she called me on the phone crying. You're not going to believe this, but this lady just rear-ended me. She said, I had no time to do nothing but say Jesus. And that word, Jesus, I believe, protected her. Because the car was a total loss. And she was relatively unscathed. Something about the name Jesus. There's power in the name Jesus. I thank God for the name Jesus. I know you guys heard all the announcements and everything, and I just want to remind that you guys, some of you will be going up to stand in for us over at Greater Harvest in San Bernardino today. Obviously, I'm not going to be able to make that trip, but Elder Laveau will represent World Faith Vision Church. Amen. And anybody else that wants to go with him, go on out there and represent us well. Amen. Let them know that World Faith Vision Church know a little something about a man named Jesus. The Bible says you want to have a friend, you got to first show yourself friendly. So we're going to show ourselves friendly. Next Saturday afternoon, I'll be preaching down at Holy Land, Church of God in Christ, in San Bernardino, California. Anybody want to go? Come on down and support your pastor. You know, we like to see a familiar face because you know when I get to preaching, I like to look at somebody and say, oh, I know they get it. Amen. I'm not as articulate as the rest of the preachers. I can't preach like them. I'm going to learn how to do it one day. And then next Sunday afternoon, our choir going to the San Fernando Valley, preaching at the oldest church in Pacoima, and some tell me it's the oldest church in the Los Angeles metro area. I know the church was before I was born, and I turned 65 today. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And the church was there before I was born. And that church has only had two pastors. The founding pastor and the pastor that's there now. Two pastors. And they were founded in 1945. The year that the peace came to the world through the armistice agreement signed by the world powers ending World War II. Amen? Now, the kids say, Pastor, you said you wouldn't go high school up in there. But we're going to teach you when we can. Amen? Amen. So all of those that are, especially the choir, and let me tell you guys something. Nothing that we do here is mandatory. I mean, you ain't got to do nothing. See, because if I tell you you got to do it, you're not doing it with a good heart. And I want you to do it cheerfully. I want you to do it because you want to do it. I want you to do it because you appreciate your assembly and you appreciate praising God. When you appreciate those two things, you will do your best. But if I say it's mandatory, you will say, oh, that pastor always making us do. Be like little children. My mama said, I got to go to school. I don't go to school. But we want to make sure that when you do it because you want to. Amen? Amen. We're having some, we didn't go over our covenant today, and because of the time, we're going to forego it today, but we will recite our covenant next week, and all those that are members already know the covenant, and if you are in agreement, say amen.
Amen.
All right, praise God. We're going to talk today about a subject that a lot of people don't like to talk about. A lot of people don't like to talk about the subject that we're going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about hell.
Come on, man.
See, pastors talk about heaven all the time because we can say a bunch of good things about heaven and make you feel real good. But if I talk about hell, somebody might feel convicted. If I talk about hell, somebody might not agree. Let me tell you why. They did a study. And the study said that 79% of people believe in God. But only 57% of people believe in hell. I'm here to tell you today, for you to believe heaven, you better believe in hell. Let's go to the scriptures, and we're going to talk about hell today. We're going to go to the book of Luke, chapter 16. We're going to start at verse number 19. Book of Luke, chapter 16, we're going to start at verse number 19. And we're going to take a different approach to these scriptures, because I'm sure that you've all heard these scriptures and that they're familiar to you in one way or another. Either you came to Bible study, or you got Big Mama, Auntie, Daddy, Big Daddy, Big Papa, somebody told you about this scripture. Because this scripture is pretty popular among the young people. The Bible said there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. I'm going to go over here and do my own thing because them folks back there is crazy. Okay. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus which was laid at his gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. It came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by angels into the bosom of Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. There's a colon out there. Y'all take note of that, because we're going to go back to that in a minute. And in hell lift up his eyes, being in torments, and sees Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy upon me. Send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us, you and me, there are a great gulf fixed, so that which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. And he said, I pray thee therefore, Father. So, okay, I get it. I got another request here. That thou would send him to my father's house, because I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham, I can see in my sanctified mind, shaking his head, said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And I can see the man pleading his case. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded through one rose from the dead. May the Lord add his blessings to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. Have you seen? You see, when it comes down to hell, there's a great rationalization. There's a great sense knowledge that says, there is no God, therefore there can be no hell. Y'all hear me? Charles Darwin said, it's a damnable doctrine. But I say, let God be true and let every man be a liar.
Amen.
Because if it ain't written,
it ain't so.
Somebody know that. You got religious people that'll tell you that there is no hell, that there is no heaven. What they'll tell you is they'll say, there is a God. He is God of love, and therefore he would not and could not send anyone to hell. This is a position of cults and agnostics. If you want to get into a cult, if you want to be a part of them that are wearing Nike tennis shoes, drinking red Kool-Aid, waiting to catch the tail end of a satellite that's supposed to be passing by, you have not endeavored to even understand the first tittle or jot or iota of the word of God. Because what thus saith the Lord shall be so. God is true. He is not a man that could lie. But then there are others, like the Christian Scientist, that says that hell is an error of the mortal mind. Jehovah's Witnesses say the wicked will be annihilated. The Mormons say that everybody's going to be saved and not suffer an eternal punishment. The Seventh-day Adventists say God will someday blot out all sin and sinners and establish a clean universe once again. I actually agree with that. I actually agree that he will do away with sin, because he said he would. But those that are corrupt will see hell. You know, man may use his pulpit or his ability to preach to promote and to tell you that hell is a myth. about that. But I say to that again, that God's word be true and that every man be a liar. It's that simple. We may not think about it, but hell is a reality. If the teachings in the Bible concerning hell is a myth, then we don't need this church. If hell is a myth, I don't need to be up here preaching. If hell is a myth, we can be watching football on Sunday instead of coming to church and giving God glory, because if we believe that hell is a myth and it's not true, then God is a liar. But I tell you one and all, let every man be a liar before God. Not only is hell a real place, but hell has some real consequences. You see, in verse number 22, you hear the man say that just let Lazarus dip his finger in the water and come and touch my tongue, because I am in torment. I am in torment. That's consequences. It also tells me that hell, you will have a full consciousness of what's going on around you. So when I hear them saying that there will be moaning and gnashing of teeth, I know that you're feeling it. You're feeling it. You are part of it. You know it. This scripture tells me that you will be able to see glory afar off. You see, it was not the fact that the rich man was a rich man, but the fact was that the rich man had an understanding of the word of God. How do I know that the rich man had an understanding of the word of God? Because once he figured out that he was in hell, he said, wait a minute, let me send Lazarus to tell my brothers that we was wrong. This hell is real. But Abraham said, wait a minute, man, they got Moses, they got the prophets, they got Isaiah, they got Ezekiel, they have every single one of our major and minor prophets that have come from the foundation of the world to tell you that hell is real. And now you think that because if I send you or Lazarus, they're going to believe. And the rich man says, you don't understand. You just don't understand what I'm trying to say. Because if one was resurrected from the dead, are y'all going to get this in a minute? If one got up that was surely dead, then I know they would believe. You see, this scripture was made for you and me. This scripture was not made for the rich man that found himself in hell. Because why? Because the Bible says that you are to walk while it is yet day, for night comes when no man can labor. See, this man was in his midnight. There was nothing else that he could do, but he could set an example so that you can understand that if one was risen, come on somebody, if one was risen from the dead, then he and my brethren would believe. I know somebody that rose from the dead. I know somebody that proclaimed the goodness and glory of God and the penance of hell. I know somebody who gave you a fair warning and an easy way to avoid this hell. You see, hell is filled with people. Real people. Hell is not filled with imaginary people. The same way that you sometimes can look at your neighbor or look at your brother and see him doing well or see him being prosperous, and you can say to yourself, well, God might have prospered him, but he ain't going to do that to me. You got to understand that there is no big and little, not one of us is puffed up one against another when it comes to hell. gonna be people in hell that you know. How do I know this? Because the scripture says I got five brothers. I got five of them. I don't want them to come here and be with me. I need for you to let me go back and tell them that this hell is real. They have to understand that hell is a place filled with real people. And it has real punishment and real consequences. We need to go back and let them avoid the tragedy that I'm in. But yet here we are in church. We got friends and family sitting at home that need to be somewhere giving God some praise. Yet we don't love them enough to mandate, to demand, to order them to, what was that word I used earlier? Mandatory. To give God some praise. Why? Because we don't want to be out of their good graces. My mama used to call herself a drug dealer. Because she drugged me to church. She drugged me to Bible study. She drugged me to pray and praise. But our kids today can tell you, today I ain't going to no church. How dare you wake me up on my day off? And we accept this. We accept this. But if we don't raise up these children in the way that God would have them to go, they won't have no rudder. They won't have no foundation. They won't have nothing to guide them when their days are dark and their clouds, the skies are cloudy. I'm here to tell you today that you can make sure today that them that you love, you can go back today. You can say you got Moses. Read the book of Exodus. You got all of the saints. You got them. Come on and read and understand that hell is real. But also avoiding hell is very real. Avoiding hell isn't even that hard. Because you want to know why? Because now we're saved by grace.
Believe also in me.
In my father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. This is easy. This is easy. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Somebody hears this today. Don't sit around thinking that this hell is a myth. Don't go to hell thinking that you ain't going nowhere. Have enough love and care for people that you know. Have enough love and care. You don't have to tell them to come to World Faith Vision Church. Tell them they need to have a relationship with Jesus. Because she is the way, the truth, and the life. That no man goes to the Father but by him. The Bible tells me in the book of Romans, the 10th chapter, the 9th verse, it said if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead for the remission of your sins, that you shall be saved. That's not hard. Why is that not hard? Because God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. That all you got to do is believe on him. And you shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We can't walk around here talking the talk. We can't walk around here not walking the walk. See, because sometimes we get so caught up in our own religion. We get caught up in our own salvation. We get caught up in our own little line. Like we're so important that the pastor talking about me. No, the pastor ain't talking about you. The pastor ain't got time to think about you. The pastor is trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save your soul. Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah, somebody. It is incredible. It's incredible to me that we can. This is my birthday. That's why I'm talking about this. Because I can get everybody to come and help me celebrate my birthday. And I can't get nobody to come and celebrate Jesus. I can find somebody if I'm going to crack open and pop bottles and pour it out. And let the food and the drink be flowing like rivers of living water. And everybody want to come and dip their cup in the drink. But when we're talking about that water that you would never thirst again. When we're talking about that food that you will never hunger again. When we're talking about a way to make a way when there's no way. I guess we don't say it with enough authority. I guess we don't say it with enough authority because I already know that the reason why people like to celebrate is because celebration is fun. You don't have to reflect on nothing when you're celebrating. That's why the Bible says in the Proverbs, oh hallelujah, it's Ecclesiastes, 7th chapter. It said, I'd rather be in a house of mourning than to be in the house of mirth. For in the house of mourning, Man's true is revealed. We are going through the motions, church. And it's time to stop going through the motions. We got to ask ourselves, what is it about that we're here to do? Am I here to look around and see who else is here? Am I here to look and find out who got a better suit than I got? Am I here to find out who got their nails did? Am I here to find out who got their hair whipped? Or am I here to give God his glory? You got to remember, he's worthy to be praised. He was him that woke you up this morning. You might have heard the alarm clock, but you could put a 10,000 alarm clocks over there at Sunset Mortuary, and ain't nobody in the back room getting up. You might have one of them apps on your phone that tell you something real cool, might play some rap music. I don't know what you got that's pleasing to you, because we put things on our apparatuses that are pleasing to us. I bet you 9 out of 10 of y'all young folks didn't even know app meant apparatus. I don't with this app. I'm just trying to tell somebody about somebody who can save your soul. We walk around here oblivious to the realities of the world and what's really going on in the world because we're so caught up, we're so wrapped up, we are so important, we are so self-centered that we can't take time to understand that we are not the only ones in need of salvation. There's somebody that needs salvation just as much, if not more, than you. The only exposure they might ever get to the word salvation, the only exposure they might ever get to the deterring of going to hell might be your Facebook page. But you put hell on your Facebook page and making it sound good, making it look appetizing, making it feel like it's someplace you want to go. See, I had somebody tell me one time. They said, Pastor, I'll tell you like this. I think I want to go to hell because all my friends going to be there. What kind of statement is that? What kind of statement is that? I heard a little, look, they told me, they said that there was a woman that had died and she went to heaven and she was talking with St. Peter at the gate. And St. Peter said, well, I want you to make a choice. I want you to make a choice. He said, you can come on and you can be here in heaven. You come on and you're going to spend a day here in heaven. And they said, and tomorrow I'm going to send you to hell and you can spend a day in hell. And you tell me which one you want to be at. You see, and so she went into heaven and everything was peaceful. Everything was love. Everything was kind. Everything, there was no suffering. There was no sickness. There was nobody old and it wasn't nobody young. Everybody seemed to be enjoying themselves in heaven. And she said she saw somebody laying on a cloud just praising God all by themselves. And she spent the whole day in heaven, basking in the glory, in the aura, in the presence of her Creator. And then the next day came. And she said, they said, are you ready to go spend a day in hell? She said, yes, I am. They put her on the elevator, sent her down to hell. She said when they walked off the elevator to hell, she said they was playing golf. She said the club was pumping. They was lit and whipped in hell. She said there was all sorts of orgies and things going on in hell. They said the music was pumping in hell. They said they had their own choir singing in hell. And she looked around hell and saw all of her friends. So they took her back up to heaven. And Peter asked her, what is your choice? She said, I like it here in heaven. The peace passes all of my understanding. Say, the glory of God is something to behold. She said, but down there in hell, they got a party going on. She said, down there in hell, they playing golf and dancing to the music. Down there in hell, everybody I used to kick it with is kicking it down there in hell. So Peter said, if that's your choice, hasta la vista, baby. Let the doughnut hit you where the good Lord split you. Come. They say when she got off the elevator to hell, she was viewing the moaning and the gnashing of teeth. She said that everybody was consumed in a lake of fire. She said that there was nothing good going on in hell. And so she went to Satan and she said, what's going on here? He said, yesterday I saw parties. I saw good times. I heard all the good music. I saw them playing golf. I saw all the things going on in hell. What's going on? And Satan looked at her and said, my dear, yesterday you were a recruit. Today you are a permanent resident. Somebody will be going home. They're going to get that. Right now, you're being recruited to hell. They showing you all the things that you think you want, you think that you desire. They're giving you an opportunity to play golf. They're giving you a chance to shake your groove thing. They let you play all the music you want to play. They got big old speakers in the back of your car, disturbing the peace of everybody you pass. Because today, you are a recruit. Today, they're trying to solicit you to a fiery hell. But I'm gonna warn you, the same way that the scriptures have warned you, they got a hell waiting on you. Oh my God. I knew a man, and I'm about to. I knew a man, friend, loved him. He used to tell him, man, come on, go to church with me.
Oh, man, ain't going to no church. I'm a good man. I don't need no church.
We're going to preach about that one day, but we ain't going to preach about that today. Couldn't get him in a church. He wouldn't walk into church for love or money. But when he died, his family wanted us to roll him into church and say good things about him. Wanted us to roll him into church, stand behind this sacred desk, and lie. I know where he is, and he's in the bosom of Abraham. I know he's in heaven, but the word of God says just the opposite. So I'm going to stand here to make you feel good and lie and take my own self to hell too. That ain't happening. Not in World Faith Vision Church. That ain't happening. That little $150 they give me ain't worth that. I'm just joking with y'all about that part, but but I want you to understand today, if you don't understand it no other day, don't come to church for singing. Don't come to church for dress. Don't come to church for form and fashion. Don't come to church because your mama taught you to go to church and it's the profitable thing to do. And you feel just as good sleeping all the way through church as you do sleeping in your easy chair at home. Come to church because you know that there is a hell. Come to church because you want to avoid that hell. Come to church because you love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. Come to church because you love your neighbor like you love yourself. The Bible says on these two simple commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Glory be the name of the Lord. Come to church because God said, forsake ye not your assembling of yourselves together in the manner of some is. Come to church because you always add your voice to mine and say, glory, hallelujah, blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's change our focus. Do we want to spend a day in hell where we have all the things that we want? They said that the rich man dined good every day. That's what the Bible says. It said that he was dressed in fine robes. And that Lazarus, by the way, this ain't the same Lazarus. This ain't Mary and Martha's brother, Lazarus. Just like my name is Danny, I'm sure somebody out here named Danny too. So don't get it twisted all up. Amen?
Amen.
Bible said there was a rich man who always clothed himself in fine haberdashery. And he reveled and he feasted and made merry every day. And at his gate there was a cat named Lazarus that didn't even bring himself there. See, the Bible says he was laid at the gate. Somebody took him and dumped him at the gate, where he would have been happy to take the crumb that fell from the rich man's table. The dogs had mercy.
mercy upon him. So they came and they licked his sores.
Hallelujah. What the scripture don't tell me here, but my sanctified mind says so, is that even in his impoverished state, Lazarus trusted and loved God. Even though he was in need better than any of us in this place, he trusted and loved God. How do I know this? Because in the book of Job, they tell me about another man who was full of sores, who trusted and loved God. And the word will do anything but return it to himself void. God's word will accomplish everything that he sent it out to do. You ought to make a pact with yourself. Look at yourself. Can't do it, can you? But you can do it inwardly. Say, self. I want, and you place the name there. You think of somebody that's right now in your life that you really want to be in heaven with. And you know they're on a one-way train to hell. You know it. I ain't got to tell you. You know it. You know, you know, you know, you know. I got folks in my life right now. I know they are. I'm not the judge. God is the judge. But his word gave me certain parameters. He gave me certain things that I can judge the fruit. Say, Lord, I want to be in heaven. And I want to be there with me. Touch their heart, Lord. Touch their minds, Lord. Let the mind that in Christ Jesus be in them. Let them come asking, what must I do to be saved? And let me be ready to say nothing but the blood of Jesus. Give yourselves a hand of praise. We're going to segue into our communion service. And we're going to do it today like this. The Bible says that if you have heart with anyone, that you should forgive them. It says, because if you partake of this sacred ordinance of the church, that you're eating and drinking damnation unto yourself. I don't want you to do that. Forgive them. Forgive them. Forgive them. Forgive them right now. Forgive them. Somebody takes longer to come to the conclusion that they're ready to forgive. Because that old devil is in your mind telling you, I don't care what that old man say up there. I'm not forgiving that person for this transgression against me. I don't care. I'm not forgiving them. I'm telling you right now, forgive them. Forgive them. In the name of Jesus Christ, forgive them. Pray their salvation in the Lord. Amen.
Repeat after me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.